Are we born sinners? Is original sin and total depravity biblical? In this series, we'll consider the doctrine's historic and modern articulations, take a critical look at potential problems that arise, examine the various passages used to teach this, considering the immediate and larger context and the grammar and word choice as we seek to be good Bereans. In this episode, we'll consider Ephesians 2 in light of Scripture and the early church's view on the two ways God sets before men. Throughout Scripture, we see God present man with a choice, life or death. And to this people you shall say, "Thus says the Lord, behold, I set before you the way of life and the way of death. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you're going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and the length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them." We see in Jeremiah and Deuteronomy that God called men to choose between the blessing of life and the curse of death, and that men are free to choose, and that our choices affect even our offspring. Not that they inherit our guilt, but often reap from our blessings or suffer the consequences of our sins. In 1 John 3, 7-8, we read, "Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning." Reflecting on such passages of Scripture and concepts, Methodius of Olympus, an early Christian bishop and martyr, wrote, "It was not God's law that became the cause of my being brought into subjection to corruption, but the devil, that he might be made manifest. He wrought evil through that which is good. The inventor of evil became and was proved to be the greatest of all sinners. For we know that the law is spiritual, so the law cannot injure anyone in any way. Spiritual things are far removed from irrational lust and sin, but I am carnal, sold under sin. This means I am carnal and placed between good and evil as a voluntary agent, so that I have it in my power to choose what I wish. For behold, I set before you life and death. This means death would result from disobedience of the spiritual law, that is, of the commandment, and from obedience to the carnal law, that is, the counsel of the serpent. By such a choice, I am sold to the devil, fallen under sin. Hence, evil, as though besieging me, clings to me and dwells in me. Justice gives me up to be sold by the evil one as a result of having violated the law." The Didache, also known as the Lord's Teaching through the 12 Apostles to the Nations, is a first century Christian treatise. It was considered by some of the early church fathers to be part of the New Testament. It carefully lays out two ways, or two paths, which men can choose. There are two ways, one of life and one of death, but there exists a great difference between the two ways. The Didascalia Apostolorum, Latin for the Teaching of the Apostles, is a 3rd century Christian writing which was likely modeled on the Didache. It also stresses man's freedom and responsibility to choose his way, either obedience or rebellion. Give heed, children of God, and do all things so that you be obedient to God, and be you pleasing in all things to the Lord our God. For if any man run after iniquity and be contrary to the will of God, the same shall be accounted unto God as heathen and ungodly. Therefore, flee and depart from all avarice and evil dealing. The teaching of Scripture, both Old and New Testament, and even that of the early church, is that man is created free and self-determinative, able to choose between life and death, obedience and rebellion, union with God, or separation from the source of life itself. Moreover, we see that man develops a character by way of his choices. Practicing righteousness develops a righteous character, whereas practicing sin develops a sinful character. In Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 3, we read, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all lived in the passion of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind." Now, if you came to Christianity by way of an Augustinian tradition, you are taught to read this passage to teach the following. As a result of Adam's sin, all mankind is born stained by sin and doomed from the womb. Consequently, you and everyone else are born with a nature deserving wrath. It's this nature which causes you to live according to the passions of the flesh and the desires of the body. You are born evil, a rebellious child of the devil. You come into existence spiritually dead as a result of Adam's sin and trespasses, and you shall die physically. However, this view begins with the extra-biblical presupposition of Augustinian original sin, and then reorders the sequence of the text so as to make it fit this presupposition which is read into the passage. We read in verse 3 of the desires of the flesh, and that is to say the appetites of the body, those things willed of the flesh. This is not a reference or a nod to original sin and total depravity, but rather speaking of those who have given themselves over to gratifying their God-given appetites. To hunger is not a sin, but to be driven by hunger into gluttony, well, that is sinful. To experience sexual desire is not sin, but to lust and engage in sex outside of marriage is. Here we see Scripture speaking to those who have given themselves over to gratifying such appetites. Hebraistically and metaphorically, one is called a son, child, or inhabitant of anything that they're addicted to or possessed by an affection for. The Greek term translated as nature can refer to the natural order as well as our origin, but in this context, we see that this is a mode of feeling and acting which, by long habit, has become our nature. Augustinians commonly assume this to be a reference to original sin and total depravity. However, contextually, we see this as a nature developed by gratifying the appetites of the body, not an inherited sinful nature, but rather nurtured by the one engaged in trespasses. The Greek term translated as wrath denotes an internal motion, especially that of plants and fruits swelling with juice. So we see that wrath is not the natural state of these sinners, but that by their sin and trespasses, they are swelling up wrath, the fruit of their sin, which in time will burst forth. If we simply let the text speak for itself, we find you, a believer in Christ, were dead in your own trespasses and sins, not physically dead, but dead relationally to the Father, just as the prodigal son was dead to his father and after his departure into rebellion. You, a believer in Christ, once walked away from him, following the course of this world and following the devil into disobedience. You, a believer in Christ, once lived like the rest of the world, serving the appetites of the body and developing a nature deserving wrath. Had you not repented and returned to the Father, like the prodigal, then you would have died physically as well, still deserving wrath and having forsaken the forgiveness offered in Christ. Yes, Ephesians 2 says it is you who committed trespasses and sins. Adam is not being addressed in this passage. You are the one who sinned and the one who developed your sin nature, and you who by your sin were bearing fruit deserving wrath. The writer of Ephesians is not making an excuse for your sin and seeking to blame Adam, but instead has rightly attributed your sins to you. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places is Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. We see God is rich in mercy, loving us even when we were dead in our trespasses. The incarnation did not enable God's love for us, nor did it enable God's ability to forgive us. No, the incarnation was the very embodiment of God's love and forgiveness. Although Ephesians 2 is often misunderstood and used to claim that men are victims of an inherited guilt and sinful nature, an honest and exegetical examination of this passage reveals it's addressing our own personal sins and our self-developed natures in bondage to our sins which condemn us, not some mythical inherited condition. While this realization should serve to convict us of our sins and our need for forgiveness, the passage continues on to address that wonderful truth of Scripture that God loves us and in his mercy has made us one in Christ, promising eternal life for all who return and remain in him. Today, God has set before you life and death, a blessing and a curse, and you are free to choose which way you'll go and what you will reap as a result. In this episode, we considered the two ways God has set before men, life and death, a blessing and a curse. And we've demonstrated how Ephesians 2 speaks of a nature which is developed by practicing sin. Please be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Share this series with your friends and family, and please do not hesitate to message us with a specific passage you would like us to consider. Thanks for watching.